5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It's the new Panic Room. It's the show other shows want to be, and the show that authors want to be on.
The all-new Panic Room radio show is brought to you by HellboundBooks.com.
Well, good evening, good evening. It is it's probably Thursday. If it's the new Panic Room, it's got to be Thursday. It is 9:30 Central Time and other times in other places. And I don't know what's what. It's just, you know, the whole thing, living in a country with more than one time zone. It's a bit of a mind-blowing thing for me, but there you go. So, hey, it is episode 109, and it's same old shite, to be quite honest with you, us again. And speaking of which, we'll bring her on. I'm going to have to bring her on. She insists on a cheer now. Xtina, my old mate mucker, how are you?
I'm good. Did you just call me the same old shite? Is that who I am now?
No. Oh, hold on. Here we go. No, I sort of stopped just before that.
Oh, okay.
I was about to, and I thought if I do call her the same old shite, I doubt if she'll ever forgive me, to be honest. So I didn't. I was very restrained, actually, quite characteristically restrained.
Good on you. Yeah.
Thank you. I think I deserve a medal or something, but maybe even a Space Force medal. That would be great. That would be great. That's my new ambition, by the way. I want to be in Space Force. So
dear.
we're gonna have to get that clip, but for the moment, we've not had him on for a while, so should we? I think we should.
We'll be right back. grab him by the pussy.
You know what uranium is, right? It's a thing called nuclear weapons and other things, like lots of things are done with uranium, including some bad things. So, yeah, again with the bad thing, think on uranium, right? Bad things. You know, the man is a, what did he say? He's a genius of sorts, but I don't think he is. I think he's a genius in the way my dog is genius, in some he can lick his own, he can lick his own balls, to be honest. And it's funny because we have the four dogs, and we have the most recent dog, which is my son's dog. His girlfriend bought him a puppy, which is not a puppy anyway. That's it. He's got a set of pods on him, seriously, honestly. He's just like, and it's funny, he like lords it up over the other dogs. He'll sit up on his back with his legs spread, look at these fuckers, look, you know, like, look at these babies, where are yours? And then he'll just make a big show of sitting sort of right close to the dogs, just licking at them, which just makes, to be fair, it makes me jealous as well. So I don't know how it makes my other poor dogs feel, to be honest,
yeah.
Bless them.
Oh God, yeah.
So that's the tone lowered.
I can see the direction the show is going to go in.
I thought you were going to say you'd like to see that. I mean, if you. I think I'll probably try and hold back, deliberately taking pictures of my dog licking his genitals because, you know, we are talking specialist dark web websites now. So, and don't tell me you haven't looked. So I guess just not do that. Let's not do. But he's a sweet puppy, but yeah, I don't like my son doesn't want to get neutered. So he's just,
yeah, you know, I was just thinking, how did we get on this? Like, and then I was like, okay, Donald Trump, I got it. Like, I had to do the, you know, I had to figure out where we were going. And now
I don't think you can't really figure it out. There's just no direction to the show. It's just ranting and just nonsense. But it has one of my favorite segments because it always catches you surprised.
What's new, pussycat? Whoa, whoa, whoa. What's new, pussycat? Whoa, 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 whoa.
So, hey, pussycat, what is new? You have
no
idea. You don't know.
No,
you don't know. You never do, do you?
I know. And every weekend I'm going to have to figure it out. I have no idea. Yeah.
You just, what? Oh, you thought of something. What is it?
Well, the only thing that jumped into my mind was the schlock. I know the schlock horror release party is tomorrow. That's all I have. But that's because we had been talking about it prior to, you know, tonight's show.
Of course, yes, so we had Brett on last week, and what a terrific guy! What a great guest! I mean, we could have a 5-hour show and still not even scratch the surface with that. Yeah, we've got to have him back on. But yeah, Schlock Horror, which is a terrific anthology, and I'm not only saying that because I'm in it, obviously. I think I like to think that me being in it is the cherry on the cake in many ways.
Definitely, because it's
inspired by 80s schlock that we all know and love well. So brilliant anthology, and of course Hellbound Books launched their new and improved website on the weekend. To critical acclaim. I think that there'll be awards. I think there will be awards if there was an award. In fact, I'll tell you what we're gonna do. We're gonna do what a lot of independent publishers do. We're gonna create our own award. Yeah.
Yes.
For
best
horror independent publisher website, and we're gonna award it to us. So we can say it's an award winning website. And the nominees are Hellbound Books. Hellbound Books.
Hellbound Books.
Yes, I'm already picked up. Me too. I'm had some slingbacks to go with it. The last minute golden buzzer is Hellbound Books. And the winner is.
Hellbound Books.
Yeah, we probably have a decent chance of winning something, which would be fantastic.
We do.
So
yeah.
I'm going to do it. And then what we can do, we can just copy everybody else. You know, we'll nominate our own authors for author awards.
Yes.
You know,
yes,
and say, you know, the you know, best-selling Hellbound Books author of the year is James Watts, and who,
yeah,
by
yeah.
pure coincidence, is a Hellbound Books author. So we can do that. And
I
then
love
we can
it.
Say, everybody. Everybody is an award winner. That's brilliant. What a great idea. Let's do
it
that.
It is. We have to get right on that. Yeah, definitely.
And, another bit of what's new, Pussycat, is that we do have a new listener, and I did promise I would shout out to her. So, hey, Janina, she should be listening. And if you're not, then, you know, I just made a fool of myself. But and it's always nice. So we've now got, what, we've doubled our listenership to two. Which is fantastic.
To two, yes.
Two. It's just, no, statistically speaking, we've increased our listenership by 200%. So, or is it 100%? I never know. Mathematics was never my strong point. We've doubled it. We've doubled our listenership.
Wasn't,
so, hey.
It wasn't mine. Study hall was my favorite, you know, in school. Study hall. I love
mine,
that.
My favorite subject was the pub. To be honest with you, I guess the equivalent here of what would be junior and senior years, like, you know, 17, 18, they were a little bit more relaxed at high school. We got the sixth form, of course, when you did your advanced level exams, uh-huh. And we would spend a decent amount. There was a pub literally around the back of the school. I mean, who builds a school that close to a pub? They're just asking for it, to be honest.
They are, yeah.
So, and we would sneak. I remember one lesson, one lad was, we got back from the pub, and we'd have a couple of pints, you know, but he'd had about seven, but he was absolutely out of his tree in the middle of, I think it was biology, and he was just absolutely, and it was funny, but in a funny way. He was just funny. And the teacher was mildly entertained as well. It was like, it was just funny. He was good.
School was so much more fun back then. We didn't have to worry about stupid school shootings and things like that.
Yeah.
You know, what did you say earlier about, you know?
School is so much more fun drunk, to be honest, I found. But try telling that to kids these days. But now, yeah, we're saying my son's high school this year's big policy to which will, you know, certainly counteract anybody thinking of bringing an AK-47 in and shooting the school up is clear backpacks. Great, you know, because you know you can fit an AK-47 into a backpack. And as my son actually did point out, I could just take a handgun in one of my folders, you know. So, there you go. So I would rather have seen metal detectors and more school cops, personally.
Yeah. Homeschool is looking better and better all the time.
Oh, no, no fucking way. No, 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 no. I will, no. Jeez, I don't like my kids that much, really.
Yeah.
To try and, in fact, in India would say, oh, you could homeschool me. No, fucking, what, you go to school? No. I've got no, it's why I'm not a teacher. I have no patience, certainly not with children.
Yeah,
no,
I don't. You know, they have it's not even the same thing as homeschool used to be back when, like, we were younger. It's a virtual school now. So you don't even, you know, the parents didn't really have to do too much. Just set them in front of the, you know, the computer.
Oh, really?
They have virtual teachers that they can call if they have a problem. And I mean, it didn't work that way when my daughter did a year of it in, like, I think it was eighth grade or something. And I basically, you know, did all her classes with her. So, I mean, it really wasn't, you know, it wasn't as freeing as I'm making it sound. But it's supposed to be, you know, they have the virtual teachers that they can call. And, you know, you really don't have to do a whole lot. But, you know, of course, we don't, you know, do things the right way. So there I was sitting there learning all about science and social studies, which I completely hated when I was in school. So it sucked, you know.
I mean, I've done my learning, my schooling, you know. Damned if I'm going through it again, you know. I said, farm the kids out. You know, fuck off, leave the house for 8 hours, you know. Just. I mean, obviously, because I work from home, you know. I mean, I just couldn't homeschool. I couldn't. But I don't know. I mean, it's funny. They all over the homeschool, and then they organise like homeschool parents organise getting the kids together. Well, isn't that school then? Isn't that the point? Isn't that what you just send them to school?
Yeah.
We get all the homeschool kids together and teach them together. Well, that's school. You fuckwit. That's school. Seriously. And statistically, again, you know, it's America. Welcome. Yeah. That is why people, that is exactly why you have Donald Trump as president, because of that. And a big number of, you know, the school shooting kids, white Christian homeschool kids, you know, they don't learn. I mean, one of the big things about school is, okay, you learn shit, and that you forget certainly by the time you get to my age. Most of it. I still have retained a startling amount, actually. But yeah. Again, ask me what I had for lunch yesterday. No idea. But it's the social. It's learning. It's the social skills as well. They learn how to get along. They learn life isn't fair. That there are bullies. That are a victim. That are all that. The social dynamic. They learn their place. They learn how to get along. And you take that away. I know homeschool kids, and they're just hopeless.
Right. Well, you know, in this day and age, anyway, with so much, you know, social media and everything, the kids are. Mm-hmm. I think they're learning. They're losing that anyway. You know, how to behave in a social setting. You know, I mean, I find it really fascinating when you're talking about your boys. Friend will come over, you know, and they'll be in different rooms playing video games, the same game together, but different rooms. I mean, that's just
He flew all the way from San Francisco. Yeah. He flew. His parents spent like $500 on his round trip plane ticket. Flew all the way. Came here. Set himself up in our spare room. Where they got the spare TV in there. He brought his PlayStation with him, so he and my brother and my son could do what they do anyway from thousands of miles away, but literally, 50 yards away from each other.
Totally worth it.
They would, if they were lucky, they'd sort of pass in the kitchen when they were both foraging for food.
Oh, that's
and that bad. Was it. And I told him, his dad said, well, that was $500 well spent, wasn't it? And it's like my daughter. I mean, she got to the bus stop, and there's her and there's the other kids. And instead of playing or interacting, they all stood there at the bus stop on their phones.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like,
yeah.
Talk to it, and like you say, the social skills are just dying. It's terrible. It really is.
I love this one meme I see occasionally. That's like, you know, we're having friends over to come stare at their phones, or you know, later. You want to come?
Yes.
And basically, yeah. I do remember one of the last times I had my girlfriend over for when we. This is forever ago when I was still in Florida, and I invited her over to watch a movie, and she did spend the whole entire time on her phone, which is bad because I pretty much do the same thing now. You know, so. I can't really say.
Well, here's the thing. My daughter, she goes to gymnastics one evening a week, and she made this friend and wanted to be a friend. And she said, a friend, because it's kind of weird for me because I'm the one who has to get the mum's phone number. So I've got literally got an absolute list of mum's phone numbers. If I was that parent, if I was that father. You know, but I'm not. I no. And her mum said, well, let's go and have the four of us a bit of dinner after gymnastics. Fine, not a problem. Let the kids have a bit of time, and I guess so. She knew if her daughter was going to come over, then because still some of my daughter's friends, I think, are a bit reluctant to have them coming over because it's like just me.
Right.
You know, and I'm not the guy from Subway. I'm not Jared from Subway. Seriously. But hey.
No.
And we went to this. She recommended this sushi place because she likes sushi. Fine. Okay. And I flatter myself that maybe she thought there might be, you know, a little bit of something, you know, where, you know, because you know I'm a bit of a catch, obviously. And
totally.
She literally don't patronise me. She don't. She spent 90% of that meal On her phone.
On her phone, yep. I mean, yep, I knew
she
it.
She was bidding on some makeup or something to catch up with the friends. And da, da, da. So it was me and the two kids chatting. And I thought, how absolutely fucking rude. Seriously.
Yep. Yeah.
You know, I just don't.
But the bad thing is,
that.
Or the good thing, I don't know which way you want to play it, but, you know, it probably wasn't you. She probably just does this to absolutely everybody, and absolutely nothing to do with you is what I'm thinking. Because, yes, you are fascinating, and you definitely are a catch, and I'm not being patronizing, I promise.
Well, I mean, the other thing, I mean, you know how much I like to talk about myself, obviously, yeah. And
uh-huh.
when we did have conversation, I learned a lot about her. She never once asked me about me.
Yeah.
And I'm not being big, it's just conversations were two ways, you know? And I heard all about and work and not, what do you do? Anything. Seriously, I thought, how fucking rude.
Yeah.
You know,
yep.
I tell you, there will not be a second date, I can tell you.
And she probably won't even realize it. She won't. You know, she's too wrapped up in herself and everything else. So you're better off. You're better off.
Well, it's just, I bumped into her this week, actually, at the class, you know, and, you know, she's trying to make a conversation. I just, no, fuck off. Just don't. Don't get on my face, bitch. I'm busy because I use that to, I take my laptop and I work obviously, and she's trying to be chatty. And I just, and she's got this younger daughter, and she was, do you always talk like that? I said, don't, seriously, are you putting on that accent? Yeah, I am. Yeah,
wow.
I said, lady, get your kid out of my face before I hit it. Really, you know. Which brings us back neatly to my point about not liking kids. So, anywho. I'm assuming we have a show this evening.
We do, yeah.
What is going on?
Well, our first guest we have is horror writer Jay Steffy, a new Hellbound author that I can't wait to read his book, to be honest. It looks
it is
really
a stonker.
Good. Yeah.
It really is. Mm-hmm.
And we again,
you know, cards on the table for our two listeners now. you know, we pre-recorded Jay Steffy's segment, which is coming up in a moment. And I just listen, stick. I mean, a fascinating guy, a brilliant, probably one of the best excerpt readings in the show's history, I feel.
I totally agree. It was great. I loved it. I definitely think that, you know, the guy that we got to do the reading should definitely do the audio for that book. I'm going to vote for that.
I think he should. He should narrate the whole audio book. So so there's that. So I think and obviously then after the break we have Armand Rosamilla, and I'll probably.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I've probably pronounced that horribly wrong. Armand, I'm sorry if you're listening. He can correct me when he comes on. So I think without further ado, hopefully I've done this right, and we will do this now. Here he comes. We should have Jay Steffy on the line. Are you there, sir?
Yeah.
Hello. Hey,
hi.
How you doing? How are you doing?
Good, yourself?
Brilliant. So we're not used to sort of, you know, doing this during the day. So, but no, hey, thank you for, so I've just given away, it's a pre-record now, you see, so. thank you for joining us. Do we call you Jay?
Yeah, that's fine.
That's good. We've got a whole list of guests who go sort of by initials. So it's kind of, you're in an elite group. Elite group, which is awesome. So, Jay Steffy, who is the author of Evolution of a Monster, which is probably, I'm just going to stick my neck out, it's probably one of the most unique and original novels I've read in a hell of a long time.
Wow.
It blew me away from the first couple of pages I read, and obviously I've been through the whole thing, and it's just, I'm not going to spoil. I'm going to let Jay tell us about it. But I mean, the tagline, which is beautifully written, I have to say, A raw, uncensored personal diary of a progressively deranged serial killer, which pretty much sums it up beautifully. I mean, Jay, I mean, what? Tell us about the book, sir.
Well, it's a guy, he just starts out as a normal guy trying to figure out what his affliction is, and he eventually, one way or another, discovers that it's his passion for murder. It's like a drug addiction. He has to try to keep that thirst quenched throughout his journey. The thing about this, it's not really written like a novel or a book, so the biggest backlash people are going to provide is the grammar, the vocabulary, the spelling. Originally, I thought and I considered going through and editing and, you know, making it really, yeah, nice and proper, but then I realized that if this is written in the heat of the moment, it's where he'll commit some kind of heinous act, and then he'll find a quiet place and start writing. In that environment, it's very unlikely that he will have, you know, a scholar mentality. So it's, in reading it, it is on purpose, you know, all the, it's all placed strategically, but really, it's just, he just travels and just killing people, and it's just really descriptive, and it's a hand diary, basically. So if you imagine somebody who never really intended to be a murderer, but found himself in that, you know, scenario, but he documented it with a diary, and then somebody discovered that diary, and that's what the book is. It's not really a book, it's a diary.
Well, I that's one of the things that strives to say is being original, and I insisted on editing it because I wanted to work on this. And yes, there's a lot of it is, you know, it went against the grain a little bit because we'd like everything to be, you know, polished. But I think had it been polished perfectly, it would have taken away from it. Because that's what I imagined. He's there. He's murdered this, and he will murder whole families. I mean, he murdered pretty much an entire campsite at one point, and then sat down, still with his hands covered in blood, and he's writing this diary. And that was what I had in my mind, and that's what we want to plant in the mind of the reader.
Yeah,
so it is rough and ready. It's not formatted like a novel. It's formatted as a diary. I mean, it's just like date, time, whatever date. Here I am. How many people killed, it reads so well.
Yeah, I went out on a limb doing it that way because, you know, the only writing I've ever done is lyrics for a metal band I used to be in, but never a book, but no real proper training or anything. So I decided, you know, why not try it? Why not do it? Something different, you know, be a little bit out there with it. And I never really intended to publish it. It was just sometimes done for fun. And then I talked to one of my friends, Becky, and she turned me on to you guys, and you know, one thing led to another, and I was surprised you guys liked it. I was actually, oh, somebody liked this craziness.
we do like crazy, and I mean, Xtina will testify. You know, I am a big fan of anything that's different. I like to book the trend,
yeah,
be a bit different, and just something unique. And this just stood out as being just, you know, very, very unique. Plus, I mean, the subject matter obviously is something that I think certainly anybody who's interested in horror or anything dark are interested in. And what I did find, you know, I've done a lot of reading about serial killers, but rather worryingly, actually, you got into the mind, the psyche of a compulsive killer. Brilliantly. I mean, it's just like it's like a drug rush. It's like he needs to kill, you know, like a cocaine addict needs to take the hit just to function and just to stop the dark thoughts and just to stop the decline. And it accelerates and just gets, you know, escalates. And but I think, you know, you even provide some nice touching moments, you know, where he takes on this child who he sees as his. And it shows that there is still a glimmer of humanity in this monster.
Mm-hmm. And
wow.
See, the title of Evolution Anyway, if you read it from beginning to end, progressive is basically the word of the day, because it starts off, you know, he starts off in such a way where he has some moral value, some kind of like set, and then as it gets worse and worse, he evolves into what you said as a monster. We have like mental lapses and a little bit of schizophrenia.
Yeah.
he really evolves into a monster. And then his compadre, like you said, that's also an evolution of another monster. And that one, you can see it in her or his behavior.
Yeah. Yeah. Which, I mean, again, you allude to the fact that that behavior was inherent anyway. Much the same as the protagonist. It's there. It's something that is like a predisposition. Like, you know, people have a predisposition to alcoholism and drug addiction and what have you, you know.
Well, I used to work at a prison, which is funny, and I also worked in an insane asylum, which I did that all before trying to write. The insane asylum I worked at, the reason I called it insane asylum instead of, like, MRDD, it's because whenever you have a court-appointed criminal who goes there because they got, you know, they got insanity plea rather than they do like a murder. They didn't go to prison. They got an insanity plea. Well, they came to us. Well, I would work with those people every day, and I would talk to them and interview them. So I got, you know, a good idea of how they tick. And then when I worked at the prison, they would, you know, you were allowed to talk to inmates about their case, but they frowned upon it because they said, you know, you can't comprehend or you really don't want to talk to them, it's going to get under your skin. So I kind of enjoy talking to them about their cases and what they do and what they think. And then all that thrown together, you know, and this. I tried to keep it as realistic as possible because every scene on there is something that could happen. I hope it doesn't. And if it does happen, I'm not the one that said do it. Just so,
yeah. That is fascinating.
So, I mean, the obviously, like you said, that you work within the system. I mean, is that what inspired you to write Evolution of a Monster?
What is it?
So, was it your experiences with those people that were your, was that your inspiration, or did you get that from somewhere else and they added to it?
That, and I went through a custody battle that helped inspire.
Yeah, I can identify with that, yes.
Wow.
Oh, yes. I've said it, you know, and again, it's going to go on record. You know, even if I could get away with it, and it's been a lot of years now, I would still quite merrily strangle my ex-wife to death. Just seriously. For the record, I would, if I could get away with it, I would kill her, and it's as simple as that.
Oh, yeah, everybody has it in them, right?
Love you.
Yeah.
Love
everybody,
you, sweetie.
Has an animal. Yeah, everybody, what I've learned with working with people in the prison system and a mental institution is that, you know, and just in general, I've been around drug addicts my whole life as well. So I put them all together in this character, and it's, you know, it's intense in that, but it could be realistic, you know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I think you've captured it very well. Like I say, I remember when I first read it, I thought, is this a diary or is it a diary? You know what I mean?
Wow. That's kind of scary.
Is an accolade, you know.
What's funny about it is when you mentioned the part about the camping scene, I read that to my mom while I was writing it. She likes that kind of stuff, so she likes hearing about it. But she said that she can't look at a tent. She can't watch anything about camping. Nothing. It just made her think about camping a whole new life. She said she kind of hates me for that because I ruined camping for her. She will never do it again.
Brilliant. Well done. Well done. Yeah. But it's one of those things. You say, you know, you're camping and you think, all right, I've got the tent around me, so I'm safe. And it's a thin bit of material, for goodness sake, you know. and it has, like, there's so many horror films where, you know, campers have been attacked. I mean, it's just, in fact, one of the best ones, I think, is Dog Soldiers, the opening of Dog Soldiers, if you've ever seen that. Great, great movie. And yeah, that was, they're in a tent and it just all went horribly wrong for them. So I think throughout the early part of the film, later, they were still finding bits of these people.
Yeah, his mindset and his ramblings are a little bit offset as well, where he's under the impression that the reason people aren't killing every day is because he thinks like a higher government force and media and everybody's making people think it's impossible to get away with it, and he discovers how easy it is through his travels.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I think you said because he kept moving and he has the intelligence to know, you know, how to evade the law and to avoid too much of a pattern. I mean, he's breaking the pattern because I think serial killers usually kill within a certain distance from their sort of home territory, because he's going across country.
I mean, if you go into somebody's house and kill everybody in the house and stay there for a couple of days, who's going to know?
Mm-hmm. That's scary. That's a scary thought. I mean, I'm a big fan of sort of home invasion horror movies, you know, and, you know, like The Strangers and Funny Games and that sort of thing. Well, and it's a scary thought.
Especially if you have a kid with you, you're going to open the door, see what the kid wants.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. Oh, God, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Speaking of serial killers, did you do any? Did you do research into serial killers aside from, you know, the prison work and stuff? I mean, did you?
No, I mean, I've watched it. I've seen and I know about a bunch of serial killers and stuff. But I tend to, I don't know. I try not to get too wrapped up on what everybody already knows because it's hard to be original.
Right. And I guess I also wanted to know, and I think we should add this to our questions, James. Who's your favorite serial killer?
I like it.
Right?
Add it on. Who's your favorite serial killer? Love that one.
All right.
Well, if I had a favorite, it'd be the ones that no one knows about yet because they're getting away with it.
Right. That's kind of creepy, but I like it.
Well, you know, I read apparently at any one time in the United States there are, I think, 22 serial killers active and uncaught, which is, you know, and there's only, you know, in a population of, what, 380 million, you know, that's a lot of people. I mean, it's just like, okay.
Yeah, I don't know.
And you don't know who they are.
Yeah. I don't know if you ever got into the, back in the day when they used to have unfiltered internet where you can see all the death sites at rotten.com and all that stuff. I used to look at that a lot when I was younger, and I don't know why I was infatuated with it, but I guess it's a good thing, I suppose.
I mean, you can still find such sites if you know where to look, obviously, but
as an adult I'm more squeamish. I'm not really looking for that kind of stuff. As a kid I liked it though.
Yeah, but yeah. I mean, it's funny because I love a horror film. You know, the gorier the better sometimes. But yeah, when it's real, it's real. You know, and it's just like, I'm like you. There was a time I used to love all that stuff, but maybe I've just got soft in my old age. I think that's. That must be it. So.
And we have an excerpt from the book Evolution of a Monster, and I believe that James was going to read it for us, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. I have been nominated.
He's a better reader than I am.
I would. Well, I got this dodgy accent, so we have to sort of do the disclaimer that this was not written with a Yorkshire accent, okay? It could be. Maybe the audio. Maybe I should do the audio book for you and you read it.
It'd make him sound very intelligent, wouldn't it?
Right.
It's making him sound very Yorkshire. I'm not sure it's the right
thing. Put some in there or something.
Well, there you go. Right, okay,
To set it up.
I was about to say, if you don't mind setting it up for us, that'd be fantastic. Off you go.
Well, they're on their travels. Him and his companion is, you know, his kid that he's adopted. They're looking around for a house to. They can kill the people in there so they can have some new clothes to wear. So they found a house that looks like the dad and the son are about their size. So that's their reason for picking this house, because they need new clothes.
Awesome.
Okay. Oh, is that my cue now? Okay. Brilliant. Here we go. Okay. Once we were close enough to see the porch, Zach held my hand tightly and started walking slower. I asked him why he was hesitating. He exclaimed that here was a kid in the target house and he didn't think we would be able to do this without hurting him. I told him I'm done worrying about that. He seemed confused, but I asked him, what's the difference between the chicken and the egg? He said, one has feathers. I said, nope, it's the taste. He chuckled a bit and asked if we were planning to hurt him too. I told him everyone dies someday and there's no better day than the one we're walking in. He loosened his grip and put some pep in his step. When we came to the house, the sun was no longer visible. We sat on the front step to figure out how to get in, but before we could consider our options, the answer was behind us. The dad opened the door and demanded to know why we were on his porch. He looked angry, but there was no fear in his eyes. He noticed I was with a child, so there's no way we were a threat. I rose to my feet and pointed the gun in his face and said, "Just a glass of water and we'll be on our way." He changed his tone very quickly into a sobbing little girl. I'm starting to get annoyed with people's tears. They used to bring me joy, but not anymore. Now they just get on my nerves. I feel embarrassed for them. It's like they really thought they were going to live for all eternity until the moment they're faced with death. Why is it such a surprise to everyone? How can they live their life knowing they will die, but never really accepting it? It's just weird. Anyway, we walked into the house after him, and by then he had already figured out who we were. He asked me to spare his family, and that if I needed to take a life tonight, he would go, as long as I left his family alone. That was actually pretty brave for someone who started off the night with baby tears, but I simply told him that he would be dying regardless of his willingness to participate. The crying began again. Around the corner ran the boy. Zach lunged at him and sunk his knife into his chest. The boy looked very upset that this just happened to him, but it wasn't but a few seconds before he wasn't worried at all. His dad lost his damn mind, so pistol whipped him upside the head with all my might. He dropped to the ground but still kept yelling, "Jason, no, why?" I'm like, "Why the fuck not? He might have grown up to be a rapist or something." I kicked him in the side of the head because apparently the whole gun thing doesn't work that well on some people. It still didn't knock him out. I think the guy was getting his energy from an overdose. But he just flat out refused to get knocked out. In my amazement, I didn't realize that there was a woman in the living room balled up into a corner, shaking and begging me to stop. Must have been the wife. I became curious as to how far she would go to save her husband. I asked Zach to bring me some bail. He laughed at our inside joke. The dad was still conscious at this point, but just barely. I didn't feel concerned about walking away from him for a minute. Zach handed me a strip of flesh and I brought it to the woman. I told her that if she would eat some son, the father shall live. She refused as she freaked out some more. I made her sit against the wall and I sat the meat in her lap. I slowly began to walk toward the man while she watched. I said, "On the count of three, he dies if you don't eat." I don't understand why it was such a difficult decision. I mean, it's not like eating it would have made any real difference. Right before I got to three, I had the gun inside of the dude's mouth with the hammer pulled back. She screamed that she would do it just to let them live. So I sat on his back and watched her eat the whole serving. I said, "Now rank that from 1 to 10, where 1 is eating cat shit and 10 being the best thing she's ever eaten." She didn't know what to say, and I could only guess at her thought process. I could see that she would want to say 1 because she didn't enjoy eating her son that much at all. When I could see her saying 10 because he was hers, and 1 would have been an insult. She didn't want to give me a number, so I started counting again. She told me 5. I guess that's fair. I mean, it's not like it was cooked or anything. If I would have had time to cook it, I'm sure she would have given it a better review. Right now, I'm still sitting here on his back, hitting him every once in a while he moves too much. The woman has already puked 4 times and is laying down facing the corner of the wall. Zach is laying on the couch. I'm not sure if he's asleep or not, but I haven't heard him say anything for about 20 minutes. I don't know what to do here. Don't get me wrong, they will die. I just don't know how. There you go.
Wow.
Sorry about the stutters there.
No, you know, you said something.
Intense stuff. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you said something at the beginning of the show about, you know, it reads like, is it like a diary or a diary? And I'm thinking, you know, of, you know, Jay, that if he told us, he would have to kill us and eat us, too.
Yeah.
That's good. Wow.
It is good. And it's sort of full of stuff like that, you know. I think what I like about it is that the matter of fact. I mean, that is just like, you know, if that was in a novel I'd written, that would have been really, you know, full of adjective, full of. But it's just so matter of fact. You know, I did this and
da-di-da.
And but that is what makes the book so damn good. You know, it's just that, like, you you're driven along by this thing, and it's just like
you're just
mentally accepting it that this guy, so he's killed the kid, killed the kid, and made the mother eat it, and it's just like, yeah, it is. It's mind blowing stuff. I love it.
I just love that. Even that last line. Don't get me wrong. They will die. I just don't know how. Yeah, I mean that's awesome. That is. I can't wait to read it.
Well, I like the way he tells the dad. You know, look. You know, yeah. It's pretty much it's admirable of you to offer to sacrifice yourself, but you're gonna die anyway.
Took
the wind out of his sails a little bit. You know.
That was awesome, and I totally did get like a sense of like that movie, The Strangers. I was just thinking that it was like he was totally in the mind of this.
Yeah.
This
well, I tell you, probably one of the best home invasion movies certainly I've seen for a long time for this sort of style is Funny Games. Have you seen that, Jay?
No, I haven't.
You should see Games. There's also, and I've actually got it, we discussed it on the show with Rainier a few weeks ago, the original version, which is Swedish, apparently is even more so, and I actually have that, and I need to sit and watch that. But again, it's just that they're just so charming, just so matter of fact about the whole thing, while they're slaughtering this family, you know, and it's like, that's what makes it, you know, there's no sinister overtones other than their actions. You know what I mean?
I suppose. Yeah, and on this, if I was writing in like a third-person narrative, it'd be more descriptive, like you said. But with it being his diary, does anybody write a diary like a novel? So, the issue with writing it though is a lot of times you can take like one scene and you can just stretch it out for so long, and I kind of get bored with that. So I would write a couple paragraphs that were exciting, and I'd put it up for a couple days until I thought of another couple paragraphs that were exciting, and then that's why. Cover to cover without a whole lot of fill-in, you know?
Which as well gives, I guess that's helped to give you that diary feel as well, because that's how you write a diary. You don't sit and write a diary in one, you know, like in 2 weeks. You do it as the protagonist has here. You do it over a period of time, which is, I guess, gives it that flavor.
Yeah,
and also like a kind of like a voyeuristic kind of thing to it too. Like if you ran across and I actually did one time. I ran across a book of writing, and it was at some kind of estate sale or something. And I, you know, I just knew that the person had, you know, passed on or something like that. And you know, I took it home with me, and it was so cool to read the, you know, this writing of this, you know, I didn't know this person, I didn't know any of the story, but you know, here I am, you know, reading their private thoughts. To me, there was something really eerie but interesting at the same time. And you know, they weren't a writer, and you could definitely tell that by reading their stuff, but it made it that much more real and that much more, I don't know, kind of creepy but compelling at the same time. Made me definitely wonder about this person. And I know,
and
you can't give us any spoilers or anything about the book, but I'm definitely wondering, you know, are we going to see him again, or, you know, is he still killing? You can't tell us. I know, but I want to know.
You have to interpret the ending, because there's going to be a couple different ways to interpret the ending, because you see him losing his, you see him like losing track of his mind and having delusions and stuff, so you don't know what the ending is, and I like it like that.
Awesome. I definitely can't wait to read this.
What is it?
Oh, I was just wondering what you were working on now.
Well, there's actually two things I'm trying to work on. See, I never considered doing the writer thing. I just wrote this because one day I decided to start writing because I've never done that before. I'm like, all right, let's write something I've never done. So I just started going, and not being a writer, having a history of it, I didn't have any rules. So I could do whatever I wanted, so that's what I did. But now, you know, getting this one out there, it's kind of cool that it worked out. So there's two more that I'm working on that might actually be more literary, you know. It's going to be more polished, and it's going to be an actual story. But there's one of them I'm working with. I don't know if this is you or whose voice is whose, but Becky, we're doing like a dual story. I'm going to do two, we're doing like two different things. There's one that's like a dual story. We're going to have, I'm writing like part of the story, and then she's going to go through and add parts to it, and we're just going to just make like one story. We're going to do that for the fun of it. It'll be a nice project. And then there's another one that I'm working on. It's going to be like a... It's not really... You know how they have all these shows out there, the post-apocalypse, post-zombies, all this stuff? I just thought about, what about post-rapture, you know, because you got rapture, which is something everybody knows about, but I don't really see a whole lot out there about what happens next, and that's what...
Right. The Left Behind series, that was, you know, the only thing, but that was a very, you know, religious look at the whole thing. I don't know. I enjoyed it, but... Now, you know, and I find it really fascinating that you were talking about, you know, that you had never really, you know, you weren't a writer and you just decided, hey, I'm going to, you know, give this a shot. I mean, most writers I know, it's something that they wanted to do for, you know, pretty much their whole life. So I do find, I mean, do you still have that drive to write? I mean, I know there are times that there is something that has to come out of me and, you know, I will stew on it for a couple of days, but it'll be, you know, in the back of my mind that I have to get something out. And then when I finally do, it is almost like, you know, I've just gone out and killed somebody or whatever, because I do get that sense of relief. Oh, it's finally, it's out, it's over. And so I do wonder if it's the same for you.
Well, anybody that knows me, my history and everything, can understand me writing that book. They're going to read that and be like, oh, yeah, he wrote that book. But then now that that's out of the way, I just sat down, and when I was writing, I didn't really, like, think about it. I just sat down and just started writing. It's like, you know, having possessed hands or something. You just sit down, write a couple thousand words in a sitting and go. And then, like I said, you'd write a couple paragraphs and walk away, come back again, kind of do a couple paragraphs again. And then as far as your question is, the imagination kind of went away after it was all out there. But then I'm sitting here trying to write again, you know, and starting to come back to me again. And I think there's still some good stories out there.
Well, we are just about out of time for our first segment. It's gone by way too fast. Can you tell us where we can find you online?
Facebook. That's probably about it right now. I know they say that the younger people are into Twitter. I'm not sure how much I want the younger people to read my stuff, but I'm on Facebook.
Awesome. We will have your links. We'll have your links put up on our Facebook page and
don't forget. Also on the Hellbound Books website, brand new website as well. So.
Oh, yeah.
Give it a look, people.
Definitely. I will have the links put up on our Facebook page and the links to the book and everything. So if anybody wants to stalk you, they know where to go. And, again, I want to thank you for coming on the show. You have to promise to come back and see us.
All righty, then.
Yay!
Okay, well, thank you. It's been an absolute pleasure. And I always say when we have, you know, authors on, we've corresponded via email for months and months. You know, it's nice to finally get to talk to you, sir. Always a pleasure.
Oh, yeah. You too.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Okay, have a good one.
All right, you guys.
Okay, bye-bye.
Radio Show is sponsored by Hellbound Books, purveyors of all manner of dark fiction. You can find the publisher along with links to all their available works across platforms at hellboundbookspublishing.com. Hellbound Books is proud to be the first in the indie publishing business with their very own app on both Google Play and the App Store. In the mood for something steamy to read, check out new erotica author Jennifer Lynn's website at jenniferlynnerotica.com. You can find James at his website, www.jameslongmore.com, and Xtina has an author page found on the Hellbound website. Don't forget to follow the Panic Room Radio Show on social media. Our Facebook page, Unofficial The Panic Room Radio Show, Twitter at Panic Room Radio, our YouTube channel, The New Panic Room Radio Show, and come visit our website at www.panicroomradio.com.
I wonder why.
Welcome back to part two.
It is part two. Hey, Xtina, what a great first segment that really was, wasn't it?
Now we have to wake up.
On a scale of one to falling down, just how drunk are you right now?
Yeah, I don't know how this next segment
I love
goes.
You! Yeah. I love you!
I love this show.
Oh my,
I love
you. You're my best friend, and I fucking love you. Oh. Awesome. I'm gonna have to drink more. I think.
I do get that way when I'm drinking. I do. I tell people I love them and I'm so affectionate and sweet. You know, as opposed to when I'm a total raging, you know, bitch. So.
Yeah, when people say that, you know, that is like you need to drink more because you're an absolute cow when you're sober, pretty much. But,
exactly.
Oh, so anywho, we have no Becky the reviewer tonight, so we're gonna have Jim and Xtina the reviewers. So here we go.
Hey, looks like it's time to review something. Oh no!
So what are we gonna review tonight? I tell you what I'm gonna review. I've just got to the end of the first season of The Handmaid's Tale, which I have to say is absolutely a addictive viewing. It is fantastic. Our new listener Janina actually that put me onto The Handmaid's Tale, and it's like, wow, you know, it's just phenomenal. Not what I was expecting, but it is so beautifully written, beautifully shot. Yeah,
on my list.
Great.
Yeah, yeah, I can't wait. I have been recommended by many people, so I definitely have to give it a shot, and I do.
Well, it's won, I think, literally every award known to man.
Wow.
I mean, for me, I mean, the last time I really got hooked on a series like this was Breaking Bad, and that was a couple of years ago. Because, again, everybody said, you've got to see it. And I thought, yeah, go on then. And I was hooked from the first 5 minutes. Same with Handmaid's Tale, you know, just the whole premise and, you know, just the way it's done is just. I'm going to have to get the book. I haven't got bloody time to read it, to be honest. I'll buy the book now and then read it when I ever retire, which is probably never. on the other side of the coin, went to see The Meg on Saturday with my daughter. And it was good. I mean, it was just a jolly old romp. It was like Jaws, but bigger, really. It took a little while to get going. I was quite fascinated with the faux science behind how they found it and everything. But it was a giggle. And it just had all the corny one-liners. But it was good. It was a jolly romp. It was a romp.
I had a Facebook friend tell me that it had some pretty decent jump scares in it, she said.
It had a couple. I mean, to be fair, it made my 9-year-old daughter jump a little bit. But, I mean, to be fair, the only reason we went to see, she wants to see The Nun. And I promised her we'll go. And, of course, I didn't realise until I came to book it, that doesn't open till next weekend, the 7th. So next weekend we're going to go see The Nun. And looking at it, that is going to scare the shit out of her, which would be great. Because she's one of these kids. Yeah, but that's what she likes. She loves... You know, she loves the scary rides. She's going to be an absolute roller coaster freak when she's tall enough to get on them. She's just an adrenaline freak. She just likes the scare and the jump. I mean, she loved it.
Yes, definitely.
We saw that at the movies on the big screen, and that was just, she was jumping and squealing like a little girl, I suppose, in many ways. But that's to be expected, really. But,
it is.
In 2 weeks' time, I'll be able to tell you what The Nun was like. But it does look pretty, because it's the latest one in the whole Conjuring universe.
Yeah,
In the two past ones, they have actually alluded to Lorraine Warren's run-ins with this nun spirit. So it'll be interesting.
Yeah, you know, the dolls that I collect, the Living Dead dolls, they have the nun.
Yes.
And awesome. I want her so bad. She looks so creepy.
You have to have that.
I know,
you have
I do.
To have that.
I know. She's so cool looking. She really is. She's definitely on my list. The creepier, the better, and I definitely want to see that. As a matter of fact, I think I'm going to be watching. I loved The Conjuring. I really did. And, you know, you said you liked the second one. Did you like the second one just as much as the first or better? Or
I did. I mean, partly it was set in London and it was based on a story that I remember being in the newspapers at the time. They got a couple of historical facts wrong, but, you know, whatever. But no, it was good. Although, having said, I think I said before, your ITV, the commercial channel over in England, they actually did their own version. It was a two-parter called the Enfield Haunting, and that was better than The Conjuring 2.
Oh, yeah.
If you get the chance to see it, maybe on BBC America or whatever, it's a two-parter with Timothy Spall, who is excellent. Brilliant, brilliant two-parter.
Now,
brilliant.
I saw The Conjuring 2. But I went into it thinking that it was going to be the same people from the first Conjuring. So when it wasn't, I was a little put off. I was like, because that's what I was expecting. So I think I need to see it again and have totally fresh eyes.
Ed and Lorraine's in it. So there's them. Worth watching again. You know, it's. I mean, I've seen it a couple of times. I saw it by myself, and then I saw it with my daughter. And I mean, she loves all that. You know, she loves the jump scares and the creepy stuff and all the rest of it. And she sleeps like a baby. I mean, she just doesn't at all, which is great. I mean, I was the same. You know, I was her age. I grew up watching the old Hammer horror films and the old late night. Saturday night black and white scary movies and Twilight Zone and all that. So, you know, and I turned out perfectly well balanced and normal.
Definitely. You definitely did.
Moving on. What's happening next?
Our next guest is Armand. I'm hoping I say his last name right. I'm going to mess it all up. Rosamilia. It looks like Rosamilia, I'm hoping.
Yeah. Well, let's bring it. Let's jolly well ask him, shall we? Armand, good evening. Good evening. First question is,
how you guys
how doing? Badly have... We're good. We're good. How badly have we butchered your surname?
You know, not that bad actually. I'm actually impressed. It's Rosamilia.
Rosamilia. Okay.
Oh,
gotcha.
Xtina wins the award for getting closer.
I was close.
But I'm foreign, so I have an excuse for bad pronunciation.
Yeah, he tries to use that, but I don't buy it. I don't.
Listen, it's Italian, and he's closer to Italy, so you should get it, no problem.
Ha,
yeah,
James.
But I am British, and we are famous for being xenophobic. So no, Italy, no matter how close it is, it's still foreign. There's like England and then foreign. You know, and it's my grandma, bless her, you know, anything that wasn't, you know, pie and chips or roast beef was foreign muck. I remember the first time we had spaghetti bolognese. My elder sister had made it at home ec at school, brought it home for us to eat. And my grandma was just turning out, why are you eating that foreign muck for? She said. So.
Wow.
it's kind of ironic that obviously living over here, I find myself in looking for the supermarkets and browsing what is essentially the foreign muck aisle. To find, you know, the British things that, you know, the few bits I can manage to find. So it's kind of, I think it's kind of the universe having its cruel joke on me.
There you go.
But so, Armand, thank you so much for joining us. Obviously, we're a little bit, we're on best behaviour because obviously you are a podcast god. So we're just, you know. A little bit in awe, to be honest with you, but you're here to talk to us about your book, Dying Days, Family Ties, which is a YA zombie novella. So yeah, tell us a bit more about it.
Well, the idea basically came because there was a couple of readers that read my Dying Days series, which is definitely not young adult. It's very extreme zombie, And they loved, while they loved it, a couple people said, hey, I would love for my kids to be able to read something that you've written. And I have three kids, and, you know, my kids are not going to read anything that I've written. And it was kind of started out as a joke. And then what was cool is there's a woman who's a huge fan and a big supporter of, you know, all the zombie authors named Misty. And they put together an anthology called Bite Size Offerings, and it was going to be, you know, young adult short zombie short stories. And I was invited to do a story. And, you know, knowing her and knowing her children, Emily and Mason, and they're both differently abled teenagers. They both have Down syndrome. And just kind of knowing them online and everything, I said, hey, can I put the kids in the story? Would it be cool? And she's like, yeah, sure. That would be, you know, that'd be kind of neat. So I wrote a short story with them, a young adult short story. And people loved it so much. I had such an outpouring of people going, where's the rest of his story? You know, give me more of this. So I ended up just saying, you know what, let me throw this up on my Patreon chapter every month. And I did that for like almost 2 years, and people just loved it. So then I was, you know what, I'm going to put it out. And it came out in July. And then August, which was really awesome, is I go to Scares That Care, the convention in Virginia every year. And I got to meet Misty. I got to meet both of the kids, Emily and Mason. And we actually got to do, for an hour, we got to, on the Saturday of the convention, they actually sat at my table and signed copies of the book. And I was able to sell
that
books with the kids. And
fantastic. Brilliant.
And it was just so, and it was so cool, the two of them, because they are just so funny, you know, together. And they were like, Emily was signing and she'd hand it to Mason, and Mason was started signing Emily, her name, and then Misty would say, no, sign your name. And it was like, let them go. It's so cute, you know, that they're, and they were so serious. I mean, they blew through about 60 copies of the books in like a few minutes, because they were like, just so, you know, we have to sign all these books, which is awesome.
Wow. Now, being that it's a zombie book, I'm always curious to find out from, you know, people who are writing about zombies, what you do differently in your zombie books. Is it the same pretty much, you know, zombie lore? Is there anything that's, you know, way different?
Well, for the original Dying Days series, it was very different. The tagline when I wrote the first one, actually the first one was Highway to Hell, and the tagline was, these zombies don't just want to bite you, they want to sexually violate you.
Wow.
So it was extremely...
Well, that's a hook.
I didn't go into details of a lot of that stuff. And uh-huh. The Dying Day series was 9 books, and it changed a lot. They evolved. I had the zombies evolve in the series, because I thought it would be pretty boring to just have the same thing, you know, for 9 books. So they evolve, they change, and I kind of get away from that after the first couple of books, which I think was a good move. So in the, obviously you can't have that in a young adult book. That's
right.
Probably frowned upon. So they're zombies. I mean, they're the classic Romero, you know, zombies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is what I was going to ask next. What is your favorite, you know, either zombie show, of course, Walking Dead, or movie? Like, what's your favorite zombie movie?
This is funny. So I'm not a big horror movie fan. I haven't been probably since I was a teenager. So for me, my favorite, actually my favorite zombie movie of all time is the Dawn of the Dead remake. That's one of those goofy movies that every time it's on, like Sci-Fi plays it like every 5 minutes, no matter what part it's on, I stop and I just watch it, you know.
Yeah.
And there's only
a few movies that I do that.
Yeah, I enjoyed that. I mean, the original Dawn of the Dead. I saw that at the movies. It was the second sort of adult film me and my friend sneaked into. The first was actually Alien. The remake, I watched it expecting to be disappointed, but they did a really good job with it. The Day of the Dead remake was terrible, but Dawn of the Dead, I was pleasantly surprised they did well with it.
Yeah, my favorite, maybe not my absolute favorite zombie whatever, but I love Zombieland. I do. I'm a huge fan. Every
Zombieland,
time.
Yeah, it's a good movie.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. That's one of those ones that every single time I see it on TV, no matter what part it's on, I have to watch. I'm, like, compelled, and, you know, I know all the songs in it, and I can probably recite dialogue occasionally, you know, so it's a great movie, and it's so much fun.
It's got everything. I mean, it's got... I mean, it's incredibly dark humor as well. And Bill Murray, I mean, Bill Murray and Woody Harrelson. I mean, you can't go wrong, can you, really?
Yeah.
And I have a huge crush on Emma Stone as well. Huge girl crush on her, so she was great.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. You're a huge girl crush, do you?
Yeah, she's second only in my book to Scarlett Johansson, who is perfect. So, end of argument. That's move on now, that's it. No argument.
Move on.
She's perfect. Moving on.
Well, I want to hear more about Dying Days, Family Ties. Do you have an excerpt that, you know, you can read for us?
I do.
How smooth was that? Yeah.
I can give you just basically the it's the first, just the first part of the short story, which ended up becoming the second chapter in the novella. I could read that to you.
Awesome.
All right. I miss my cats, Emily said to her brother Mason, who was busy staring at the dead, bloody man below them. It was moving, but shouldn't be. I miss pierogies, Mason mumbled. What did you say? I can never hear you. Because I'm talking to myself, he said, even lower than before. Stop looking at him. Come over here and help me with this, Emily said. She'd been trying to loosen the screws in the vent shaft for nearly an hour and had only managed to crack two of her fingernails and move the first screw half an inch. Mason walked over, careful not to slip and fall through the holes in the crumbling floor. Emily went back to her work. If they didn't get the cover off, they'd have no way to get off this floor. What was left of it, anyway. She glanced at her brother, who she wanted to be really mad at, but could never stay mad at for long. This is your fault, she said. Mason shook his head and pushed her gently away. If I hadn't gotten us up this far, we'd be down there with him. You should be thanking me, Em. She refused to. She didn't want to tell him she was scared, but by the look in his eyes, Mason already knew. He always knew. They could talk without saying a word at times. It had driven Mom and Dad crazy, but after a while they had ignored it. Everyone had ignored it. The teachers and other students at school. Give kids the World Village staff when they went to Florida. I missed a snoring tree, Emily said. I miss my compound bow, Mason said, and stopped trying to unscrew the vent. He stood and looked around. We have no weapons. We don't need any. I'm not going to fight anyone. I'm a kid, Emily said. We're not kids anymore. Mason stooped and picked up a bent piece of metal. It was round and sharp at the edge. He thrust his arm forward a few times. What are you doing? His sister asked. Finding us weapons, duh, he said, and continued to experiment with his dagger. It would have to do until he could find a bow and some arrows. I'm going to keep working on our escape since you have gotten distracted as usual, Emily said. No wonder Miss Tasha left us. She turned to see if her brother was going to be mad at her for mentioning what had happened. Mason kicked a rock and watched it sail off into the sky. He seemed to be ignoring the statement. Mason walked in a circle and found the biggest piece of crumbled wall he could and went back to the edge. Be careful, Emily said. She didn't want Mason to fall off the side and leave her all alone. Mason hefted the block of stone and held it above his head. If I drop it and he dies again, will you still be able to see him? I don't want to think about it, she said. I want to find out, Mason said. Emily didn't want to look. She didn't want to look over the side and see the zombie, because then she'd cry again. She wanted to be done with crying already. She heard the thud, and her brother whooped in delight. Sometimes he was such a baby. Mason clapped. I had it right in the head. It's a he, not an it, Emily said. When they die, they become it. Oh, wait, was Miss Tasha's sister still a girl, Mason asked. Emily turned to look at him, because she didn't know if he was trying to get her mad was genuinely curious. She couldn't tell by the blank look on his face, though. Help me get this loose or we'll starve to death up here, Emily finally said. Emily didn't think they were its. They were still people, but they were different now. Mean. They weren't ever going to be nice again, but she still didn't think they were no longer people.
Wow.
So that's
that.
The first part of it.
I love that. Yeah, that's great.
I liked how they were discussing what they missed. That was pretty cool. I like that.
Yeah. It was neat because I got to talk to the kids. I got to send messages back and forth when I was writing it. and say to their mom, you know, what are the kids into? He's very big on the, remember the movie Battleship?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That came out a few years ago. Yeah. He loves that movie for whatever reason. So I mentioned that in a part of the book. And just like the little, you know, all the things that they that they're actually into, which is cool.
No, that's excellent. I love the fact that they were in it. That's brilliant.
Are there going to be more in the series, or is it? Yeah.
I end it so it's a complete story. I did not want to do it, you know, where cliffhangers and all that. But there's obviously enough world that I could write a bunch more. But I kind of left it there. My idea is if the sales warrant it, you know, then I'll write another book at some point. But I didn't go into it right thinking, okay, this is going to be a trilogy or this is going to be an open-ended thing. I really just wanted to write, 25,000-30,000 word novella that just basically tells this story.
Awesome. I love zombies. I'm going to have to read this. I am. I'm a huge fan of them. I think that, you know, I've heard a lot of people talking about, because there are so many zombie movies out there, that they're kind of, you know, over it or whatever. And I'm not. I think zombies are totally cool. I mean, you know, I really do. As creepy as they are, I think they're pretty cool. Now, are they the fast zombies or the slow ones, the ones that you could, like, totally outrun? Or they those creepy fast
zombies? These are the slow zombies. These are slow zombies.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
The ones from, what was that movie, 28 Days? Is that what it's called, 28 Days?
28 Days.
You do it. Yeah, James is doing his monster robotic voice thingy that usually doesn't happen until the very end of the show, but he is doing it now a little early. But yeah,
well, in the Dawn of the Dead remake, there was the fast zombies, which was that was the first time I saw it, and that was scary.
Yeah, no, seriously, they really are. In that movie, 28 Days, 28 Weeks, whatever it is, oh my gosh, they were so fast and so just creepy that I much prefer the ones that just kind of, you know, lumber around, you know, along, and you can totally outrun those, so they're not quite as scary. So are you a fan of the Walking Dead movie with the zombies?
You know, when the show first came out, I was excited, and I watched it, and I was actually a fan of, not a huge fan, but I knew about the comic book, and so I had read a bunch of them. A buddy of mine had them, and so I had read them, like the first year or so of it, and so I was a fan. And then when I started, I think it was maybe the third season, I stopped watching because I was. I wrote like two zombie books that year, two of the different Dying Days, and I didn't want to be watching or reading zombie stuff while I was writing it. So I wrote those, and then I kind of caught up, and then it kind of became the routine every year of once the season's over, then I just binge watch them over a weekend. But to be honest, the last couple, I didn't even watch last season. And the two seasons before that was really just kind of dragging for me. And it was almost like, let's just hurry up and watch all of them so we can get it off the DVR and go on to something else.
You know, a friend of mine who watched most of the shows, I don't think he's watched the last couple of seasons, but, you know, I was asking, are you going to catch up? Are you going to watch, you know, the rest of it? And he's like, you know, no, not really. I'm so bored of it. He goes, I'm kind of rooting for the zombies now. And I just thought that was great. I'm rooting for the zombies. But, I was a fan of the show. I mean, I think I liked the idea, you know, but I don't know, for me it became a little, I don't know. The last episode I watched was, and spoiler alert if anybody hasn't seen, you know, all of it, the last thing I saw was when they killed Glenn. I mean, to me that was, and I love horror. I do. I'm a horror fan, and I even love, like, the Rob Zombie stuff when he is so gruesome. But for me, when they killed off Glenn, that was too much. I couldn't even watch that, and that was the last show I watched. I don't know if that makes me a big wuss or what, but that was, I loved him. I did, and that was gruesome. So I haven't watched since, but I may. And how about, what is the other Fear the Walking Dead? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, that to me is unwatchable. And I know people love it. I can't watch it. We watched like the first, say, three or four episodes when it came out, and I said, I hate all these people. Like, I don't like any – they make the stupidest decisions, and I just – this family, I hope this family dies, and they just start over with another because I just didn't like any of them. And we give everything, like, three episodes, maybe four.
Uh-huh.
And and I'm like, you know what? We got so much to watch. There's so many offerings that if it doesn't hook us from the beginning, and that did not.
Yeah, you know, as silly as it sounds, the red-haired chick from that show, I don't like her as an actress. So right then, I was like, I'm not gonna like this. Just and it was probably a stupid reason, but because I do know a lot of people who really enjoy that show. But I think I did a couple episodes as well, and I just wasn't. It didn't grab me. I don't know. Life is too short to watch crappy stuff.
Z Nation I didn't like. We started that, or the iZombie one. I mean, pretty much any of those, we tried a couple of episodes, and I said, I'm just really not really not into any of these.
No, time is ticking by, and you know I have to ask you. When I was asking you to come on the show, and we're picking a time and everything, you said it has to be the second segment because of baseball, and just baseball. And so, okay, is it a AAA or AA or Major League? Well, what are you watching? What baseball are you watching?
We are season ticket holders to the Jacksonville Jumbo Shrimp, which is the AA for the Miami Marlins. And,
that is so cool.
It's about 15-20 minutes from us. In fact, we're such big fans, we have players that actually live with us.
Wow.
So at any given point, we have two, maybe sometimes like three players that actually will stay here during the season, and which is
so
really cool. And we go to pretty much almost every game. And I even wrote a book. Last year I wrote the end of the season, I wrote a book called A View from My Seat, My Season with the Jumbo Shrimp. And it has basically the entire season, all their games, and then personal stories from me growing up in a huge – I'm originally from New Jersey, but I'm a huge Red Sox fan. Growing up in a family of Yankee fans, and my dad's a Tigers fan. So it's pretty cool. It's just basically all those old stories.
I was stalking your Facebook, and I saw you and your wife, I believe. You both had the Red Sox gear on. I was like, I am actually a huge, Toronto Blue Jays fan. Don't question why. I'm not Canadian, but I love the Blue Jays. And, you mentioned the Florida Marlins. That's who the Blue Jays. We start a series with them tomorrow, and I will be, glued to my TV, and I don't even know why, because the Blue Jays are really sucking so bad this season. I'm actually wondering, who are they, who are they rooting for? Because they're not rooting for themselves, or who they're playing for. I don't even know. I think that, I think
but
the game's
wait,
fixed right now. So.
Vlad Jr.'s coming up for the Blue Jays. The Blue Jays have a lot of really, really good players in the minor leagues right now coming up.
You got
another year or two.
But they keep playing the crappy ones, and not only that, but they're you're laughing, but it's true, and they're getting rid of all the good ones. We have this one pitcher, a relief pitcher, Biagini, and I'm telling you, I don't understand what it is. And even when he's out on the mound, I swear to you, he's got this look in his eyes like, even I don't know why they're playing me. I suck. Like, seriously, it's awful. And I'm yelling at my TV, and I'm getting all excited. And, of course, nothing changes. I'm just really hoping for a better season next year.
Well,
but,
you ain't going to have one next year. But maybe the year after, then they'll start. They're never gonna spend the money like the Red Sox and the Yankees, so you're never going to win anything, but at least you'll have some good reasons.
It'll still be fun. And, we are actually, I was excited at the beginning of the season, so I really don't know what happened. We took a turn, and, all I can say is we're not doing the worst. That's, what I'm excited for. I mean, have you seen the Orioles, what they're doing? Oh, my gosh, I don't even know. Yeah. I mean, I think I would give up being a baseball fan if I was an Orioles fan. I really do.
Well, they the Orioles, the organization as an organization doesn't know what they're doing. And that's, at least with, you're a Blue Jays fan, you can go, okay, they have some really good guys in the minor leagues coming up. And they're actually making efforts to trade for some good pitcher and pitching and everything else. So you got a chance. Orioles are just like shooting themselves in the foot every year. So they're not going to be anything for about 20 more years.
Wow, that's a long time. Oh, I hate weird. Yeah, James is messaging me, telling me to wrap it up. So I'm doing
no,
it.
No,
I am
actually. I've been here, been back for a few minutes, but you guys are just doing all of that, and I can't contribute because I know nothing about the game other
baseball.
Than that.
Yeah.
I sat for a Padres game about 10-12 years ago, and it bored me to tears. So, and I'm from England. I've sat through cricket as well. So, nice listening to you crazy kids talking baseball.
I'm thinking we need to have Armand on again and dedicate the whole segment just to baseball. That would be so much fun for me.
Could we?
I would love that.
Yay! As a matter of fact, I think we should have a game playing on in the background, and then me and you can just, like, commentate the whole thing. That would be awesome.
There you go.
So,
we'll do a Red Sox-Blue Jays game.
Yes!
There you go.
Oh. I hate this. We are out of...
And I can have the night off. Hurrah!
No. we are just about out of time for our show, and I hate this. And can you tell us real quick where we can find you online?
The easiest place would be on Facebook at Author Armand Rosamilia. I am also on Twitter at Armand Author. I have a Patreon page. Just look up Armand Rosamilia. And you can find my podcasts, Armcast Podcast, and also the Mondo Method Podcast, which I co-host with Chuck Buddha on Project Entertainment Network.
Awesome. And you have to promise to come back and see us again.
Definitely, but only if we talk. We all are going to talk baseball.
Yay!
James
isn't going to... He's not going to just drop off, like, conveniently like he did this time.
Exactly. So...
I will do my best. No, thank you so much for joining us. And sadly, it is that time when we have to say goodnight, Xtina.
Goodnight, Xtina.